I'd like to introduce the two new members of our panel. We have at this end Dr. Phil Kearney, who is Director of External Licensing for MSD Australia. And sitting next to him is Dr. Yagdev Sidhu, who's Senior Director of Clinical Pharmacology and Early Development at CSL. So I'd like to throw it open for some questions. I'm happy to start off if nobody has a question. So to start off with, Phil and Yagdev, I'd like to ask you about the process of getting early clinical alignment with research. So when somebody comes to you with a development that they've got or a basic research proposal or drug, how early do you want to see those sorts of things? How early do you want to get some clinical alignment and be looking at the process for commercialisation going forward?
Okay, so I think that's a critical question. I think you can never be too early. So the way we deal with it, I guess, in the pharma world is this concept of a target product profile or target product strategy, which is really, you've got to be able to visualize where you want to be when you finally commercialize it, when it finally gets to patients commercially. So you set out your requirements for commercialization, things like dosing frequency, dosing route of administration, the main clinical endpoints or efficacy outcomes that you wish to have that product deliver. And I guess that focuses your clinical program. This is what you really want to achieve. It's a minimum, and then there's an upside, and obviously there's a downside which you don't accept. If you don't meet those requirements, you may question your whole program. So that you don't have to set, the pharma sector does set this target product strategy or profile to guide the whole process, to guide the team as to this is what we're aiming for the whole project. And it goes all the way back then to research. Well, is it a viable candidate? And then the early clinical program should start targeting what that target strategy profile is endeavoring to achieve. You could take a similar approach, I guess, without formalizing a target product profile or strategy. You can say, this is my profile or my aim, and what do I need to do clinically to align to that? And the reason that's important is then you've also got to do the preclinical studies to enable the early clinical program, which will start meeting that studies. You don't want to be in a situation where you do a lot of your non-clinical programs, your pharmacology assessments, your tox assessments. You say, right, I'm ready to go into the clinic, and find that, well, you're very limited in what you can do clinically because you haven't got the non-clinical data or information to support your clinical program. So really, you can't not think about your clinical strategy early enough. It is imperative. The other area is about, what information do you need to start entering into clinic. That's a separate topic I guess we can also discuss. But Phil, I don't know if you want to.
I guess I would only add to that from my role, which is about engaging with biotechs and licensing in products for the research laboratories, if you haven't thought about your clinical development and you say to somebody like me, well, you do the clinical development, if you haven't thought about it, it makes that conversation far less likely to proceed. So from a commercial point of view, if you want to develop your program commercially, think about it early. And the point that Yadav made is around everything really flows from the end point. What is it that you will make as your claim or your product profile for your product when it gets to the market, when it's on the bench? That informs your trials, and how you do your trials is informed by your preclinical development. So really, by the time you're jabbing mice, you should be thinking about the clinical development and the endpoint and the product.
So going back to your prior statement, what information do you need when you're setting in that basic thing, when you're going to a clinical trial?
Right, so just one more point I want to add on that previous issue as well. Often you might be dealing with a program where there could be a range of indications that you can go for. So you could be dealing with you could be developing a protein or an antibody to an immunological target, which could have a range of immunological conditions. So it's going to be hard to say, well, okay, I really want to target SLE or rheumatoid or something like that. There could be a whole range of it, and it's difficult to know early on where to target your non-clinical studies in terms of proving non-clinical efficacy in which models. So you have to keep that broad. So I think that then flows on to the next topic as to what information is needed for what we'd call early clinical development. And you can really put them into two areas. One is something that Jason touched upon. You have mandatory toxicology requirements. You know, you need two species tox, rodent and non-rodent. And if it's a non-rodent, is it a non-human primate, which is typically used in antibody research? And that's quite a specialized field, which you probably, you need some expert toxicology consultation on. The other area is obviously your non-clinical pharmacology that's needed to generate the data to go into your early clinical program. And you really got to think, what information do I need to support the early clinical program that will define what's going to be assessed in the early clinical, in that early clinical program. So can I derive some biomarkers or translational models, and we can talk about some of these as well, about what to do in the early clinical program, what data to generate in the early clinical program that's going to make your asset more attractive and more informative for a potential partner and so forth. So maybe you can come on to that next, but in terms of, you really got to think early on, what pharmacological information do I need? I'm not just going to do half a dozen mice or other rodents, generate some data and think that I can go into the clinic. That's not going to work. And again, obviously, it is very case by case, and it's indication and disease area dependent as well. It's going to be different from oncology to immunology or diabetes.
I can just add quickly to that. The philosophy inside of Merck Research is that you cannot start a preclinical program without you have human genetic data around the target, and you must have a marker of drug target engagement. So that's not just, do I see a knockdown? You actually have to show that you're hitting the target you'll say you are hitting, and then that biomarker of efficacy must be translatable from the rodent model to humans. So you can't go back at the end of your preclinical studies and say, now I need another new. It has to be the same one. So they're the three sort of precepts.
Jason, when you're looking at a phase one study coming to you, what are the things when someone comes to you and says they want to do a phase one study, what's the data you look for that is critical to be included for you to say, yes, this is likely to be a valid and successful thing?
Yeah, so I guess our primary concern is safety of the participants, and so and then the feasibility of it. If it's a very, is it something we can do in the unit? If it's a, a new antibody or a small molecule, and it's a single ascending dose, multiple ascending dose study with pharmacokinetics, pharmacodynamics, safety, we can probably do that. There might be some more unusual investigations like echocardiograms, frequent echocardiograms for a cardiology drug, which we can do. But then I think the biology is important. I guess it's trying to understand. I think Jagdeo would say has said that, understanding how the biology is going to be related ultimately to the drug, as what, and therefore how it's related to its clinical use. So it has to make sense, I think, for us, for us to want to be enthusiastic about taking it on. It needs to, for us, and also for our ethics committee, to want to allow this drug to be tested in humans and expose volunteers to risk, even though that's minimized, but there's some level of risk. There needs to be some, positive outcome. It has to have the objective has to be to create a new therapeutic or diagnostic that's going to be useful in human health. So that's important. So the biology, the ultimate use or the efficacious use of the therapeutic that's being studied, and then probably most critical, as I alluded to, is the safety. Is the drug safe? You look at the toxicology. Are the kinds of side effects you're seeing very worrisome, or is it pretty clean and there's not much toxicity? If the toxicity occurs, is it only at doses that are way higher than those doses that are expected to be therapeutic, or is there a decent therapeutic window, in other words? And what kind of are those sorts of toxicities easily detectable? Can we do blood tests for liver function or kidney function and pick these things up early so we can stop dosing the drug, or is it something that's going to be more insidious and might present with a full-blown nasty toxicity that we don't want to see. How aggressive is the sponsor in terms of, you know, allowing us to, you know, to, you know, in terms of dose escalation? So what is the starting dose? The starting dose, we remember, we know what it is in an animal, but we don't know what a safe dose is in a human. So we've got to start at a sufficiently low starting dose, but it still has to be feasible, so it can't be vanishingly low. And then what are the steps in terms of how much can you escalate each time when you increase the dose in each new group of people? And is the sponsor being reasonable about, you know, the increments, so that they're not too big, they can't be too small, or it'll take forever to be not feasible to do the study, but are they reasonable increments? Will it be guided by PK? Will we have real-time PK so we can assess where we are biologically? Will we have real-time pharmacodynamic biomarker data, which will help us understand, right, well, we're at a level where we think we need to be, and we don't have to push this dose anymore. I guess we don't like, and our ethics committee don't like seeing, and I think Big Pharma don't like this either, the sorts of study design where you go into a healthy volunteer population and you decide to basically do, one of your endpoints is to define the maximum tolerated dose, which is fine in an oncology setting, but in healthy volunteers, you want to set out what we like to set out for, and what our ethics committee likes to see is a pharmacological endpoint. We don't deliberately set out to cause toxicity, to push the margins of where the dose, you know, is tolerable, because you may overshoot and you may see some, you know, toxicity that you didn't want to see.
I think there's two important points I want to make. You can never underestimate how big a deal it is to do a first-in-human study. Now, I don't know how many of you will actually be involved in the conduct of a very first-in-human trial, the very first time a particular drug, molecule, antibody, protein goes into a human being for the very first time. It is an enormous big deal. It is fraught with risk. I think you can never underestimate that. So all pharma companies, and I know for CSL, I've established what I call a first-in-human review committee, which is a collection of experts from all different functions in an organization, non-clinical, clinical, tox, regulatory, research, everything, to really go through every single aspect of data before we okay going to a first-in-human program, reviewing all the data, dose calculations. You know, dose is so critical. You're all very aware of the 2006 trial disaster in the UK. It was all coming down to too high a dose that was selected for that particular antibody.
So do people know about the 2006 disaster?
So just very briefly, so we've had two trial disasters, I guess, in Europe. One was 2006. It was a problem in a disastrous trial, really, in conducted in Paraxel in Northwick Park in UK, in just outside London, by a company called Tegenero, a German company. It was really a pro-inflammatory, I guess, program, where basically the dose that was calculated on traditional methods, they didn't really look, and this is a whole different area we don't need to go into, on how you derive your doses. The dose was calculated to be too high, given to subjects, and within a few hours, they dosed all four subjects together, and that's no longer done. You sort of stagger your dosing now. And they had severe reactions. No one actually died, but people did lose limbs and fingers and legs and so forth. The other one was earlier last year. There's a company, a Spanish company called Bilal, obviously in Spain. And it wasn't a first-in-human study. Actually, it was an early study that previously exposed subjects to a small molecule. But they did a follow-up study with repeat dosing in healthy volunteers, and one subject did die there due to severe CNS necrosis, etc. Again, not understanding the dose and the pharmacology well enough. But these are what you call early development studies, where dosing is a massive deal. You get your dosing wrong, that's the end of your program and probably half your career as well.
Yeah, so phase one studies are seriously risky. They go badly rarely, but when they do, they have the capacity to go seriously wrong. It's a rarity, luckily, and that's why we continue on doing them, but there is that window, and I think that's a very important point. These are, your first in man is a very serious step to be taking, and there is good reason why you require a bulk and a set things in your preclinical work, because that preclinical work must justify the risk that you're exposing your healthy patients to, and it is a significant risk.
Yeah. I've got a question about clinical trials being carried out in different countries. So in a day and age where collaborations are prolific across different countries, do clinical trials get applied across different jurisdictions? Or if they don't, then within a certain country, would you consider one country or one area, Europe, US, Australasia, over others in terms of competition if you're looking at your checkpoint blockade drugs, etc.?
So Merck protocols come from the US. They're a global protocol and they are sent out to subsidiaries across the world, and each subsidiary will bid for a certain number of slots on that trial. So Australia might contribute 10 in a trial. So yes, the same protocol goes across the globe and is applied equally in all jurisdictions. There are some interesting countries, Korea, Japan, where you must do trials in that nationality to register in that country. And so you will do specific trials in some jurisdictions based on the local legislation.
So I guess it depends on why you'd want to go, obviously, to different countries. It's going to take a lot more logistical, operational effort to do so. And you're dealing with different regulators, so you're going to increase the volume of your regulatory work that you have to do for different dossiers of different countries, and then possibly translations and so forth. I guess what you mustn't do is what, you know, some companies have been guilty of in the past in Europe, where they say, okay, we'll do a particular study in Eastern Europe. The regulatory environment is a bit more lax. The standard should not be compromised. You may want to conduct it in a Eastern European country because of the availability of patients, because they don't have standard of care, so therefore there's more availability of patients, the recruitment might be better. But the standard of your protocol should be as if you were doing it in any other country in the world. That's sort of important to consider.
So the competition, if you look at Australia, we only get a fraction of the worldwide clinical trials portfolio. We only see a small fraction of it. Part of the reason we only see a small fraction of it is that we are a small market. So we're a great test market. We have good R&D tax credits. We have a relatively rapid ATREC process with national mutual acceptance. We have the CTN process, which is rapid through regulatory processes. But we are a first world country, so our staff is expensive. Our data is very good. So we're okay in some specific areas. We're okay for early phase trials. We're often included in the bigger studies, the big multinationals. But we're expensive compared to others. We traditionally have a reputation of being slow, and we have a reputation of slow recruitment. So this is why it's pushed a lot of Eastern Europe, India, China, those sorts of areas have pushed very strongly to be able to do very large trials very quickly. They've got access to a huge population. But the data isn't always as reliable as you will get from here. The good thing with Australia, doing trials in Australia, is our data is accepted by the FDA and the EMA. They will accept Australian data without query. So there's good pathways through that. So we have high quality data, but competitively we have to keep our processes going really well to be competitive. We're a really good test market for early studies. Sorry.
Hi. So you mentioned that you might run a small phase one trial in patients and maybe look for efficacy, maybe not. But I'm wondering, when you get, even in those studies or in phase two studies, what happens if it is like a line ball call, like whether you're getting efficacy or not? Do you think that that's just been a problem with the trial designers and you should never have that situation? Or do you think that that's something that can happen and then you have to make a decision at the time? Or would you never go on the line ball call, I guess?
I guess it comes down to assessment of risk. What you call a line ball call or grey area is far more common than you'd think. It's not as common in some of the later phase studies to have clear-cut winners or losers as well. Often there is that grey zone, and you think, well, okay, do I need to do a subsequent study to add more information to bolster my confidence before I embark on, say, going to phase three. It's a major investment, and, you know, do I need a bit more data to reconfirm a few things or rule something out? I personally think it's very case by case, but.
So a lot of clinical trials I have seen have been double blind. You had mentioned triple blind and single blind, and I was just wondering, are there reasons that you would do single blind? Like, is it, you know, a risk that makes, you know, you have to do single blind, or in what situations would you do triple blind studies?
I don't design the studies, I just do.
Look, blinding is, so the standard is the randomized controlled blinded study. Nowadays we don't tend to refer how blinded it is, but a single blind, as I said, is when the patient is blinded but the clinician is not. You must have a very definitive endpoint. You must have a hard endpoint that is not subject to bias. Similarly, when you get triple blind, so your assessor, so your patient, your clinician and your assessor are all blinded, then you've actually got no capacity for bias. And that's by far the best, but it can be very complex to organise. So it depends how your study is designed and what your endpoints are and what capacity you have to do that, really. So, yeah, if you're doing a large phase three, I would have thought most of yours would be fully blinded. Yeah, we wouldn't go, but it depends on some of the earlier studies, possibly not.
Yeah, look, blinding is, in phase one, blinding occurs most of the time in healthy volunteer studies and never in oncology studies, and some way you're able to progress drugs through both areas. But I guess in a healthy volunteer context, the reason for double blinding is so that, you know, those headaches that people get from caffeine withdrawal when the healthy volunteers come in the night before, most of the studies exclude you from having caffeine. So everyone, like a lot of people get headaches. And when you go back and unblind and write the clinical study report, the distribution of headaches is equal between the placebos and the actives. And then you can be reassured that your drug doesn't cause headaches. So it is helpful, and it does stop investigators from, they're on the drug, therefore the headache must have been due to the drug mentality. So it helps for objective reporting and assessment. But there are all sorts of different situations. So in oncology, as I said, there's no blinding generally. Everyone's on active. and drugs still manage to work their way through oncology studies and go into phase two and phase three studies. And in some of our sponsors will have the investigator and the participants blinded, but the sponsors unblinded. That's a little unusual, but that happens as well.
So obviously... if you're doing single blinding or open label studies, they're much easier to recruit, easier to conduct. That's clear. And obviously, the greater levels of blinding, the more complicated. But you also have to think, you know, what are you doing the blinding for? If it's primarily safety, think of the consequences. If I go for a single blind, there's going to be consequences in how my safety be, as Megan says, you know, the bias aspect, how be it interpreted, that your data may be less useful. So sometimes there's a bit more pain for the gain.
I have a question about safety and toxicity for when you repurpose drugs, which was mentioned before as well. Let's say you have a drug that's approved or has been tested in an oncology setting. Obviously, there's a higher tolerance for side effects or toxicity. And let's say you find in your preclinical studies that it works in type 1 diabetes. Would you have to go back and do safety and toxicity in healthy volunteers to be able to initiate further studies, or how would you go about that?
Yeah, it's hard to have a generic answer to that. There are several factors that determine it. You know, it depends on the situation you're in, you know. Phil was just saying it depends on the dose, but it depends on what aspects you're reformulating. You could reformulate to an extent where the reformulation, you can just do some in vitro or non-clinical comparison studies and make a justifiable case. There are regulatory guidelines to allow you to do that. But if it's a significant reformulation, such that if you maybe have a tenfold more concentrated solution for injection, you typically would have to do some sort of a you know, biocompatibility study, and that should be sufficient for you to continue. The various aspects of reformulation.
If you took the exact same drug, like an approved drug, say a check inhibitor, ruxolitinib, and you use that and you want to test it for a different indication without having to reformulate the drug itself.
So there are toxicological requirements depending on your indication as well. It could be different. So that's why you need a specialist toxicology consultancy advice as to whether for that new indication then are there different toxicological requirements. Dose would be a big issue. If your dosing if the dose required is going to be pretty much the same, then that's or it's going to be vastly different. In the immunoglobulin fields, the doses on depending on which indication you go with could be quite different, and there, you know, your requirements might be vastly different. So we had a case where we had a C1 esterase inhibitor for hereditary angioedema. The current product on the market is mainly intravenous, and our formulation people came up with a tenfold more concentrated formulation for subcutaneous administration. So there is a clear case we have to go through the whole clinical program again. We have to redo the efficacy program and with supporting tox as well. But for an immunology program where the dose is, you know, say for immunoglobulin program, the dose is not that different and it's still intravenous, same sort of formulation, your requirements, you could just do a minimal clinical study.
Could I just add? I think, you know, this is, I agree, it's very circumstance or drug dependent. You know, you may have all the preclinical data in a rodent and a non-rodent that you need to go into a healthy volunteer study. And then into the indication that you want, or then again you may not. And I think it's when you know no one's going to expect you to know the answer to that, and I think you've just got to go and find people in the clinical research area that can help answer that, or the, you know, the contract research organizations, there'll be folks that'll be able to answer that, toxicologists. But you know, you could come and talk to a place like, you know, like me at Nucleus, or if it's a, you know, you could go and find an endocrinologist, or you know, you find a, you know, there are people you can ask, and certainly, if it's a local, you know, if it's a local spin out or it's a local company, you know, we're always happy just to have a chat about. And I think it's an important message that many of us, like me or and others at, you know, similar organisations to Nucleus Network, are kind of, you know, always happy to have a chat to local scientists if you think you've got something, and we can perhaps point you in the right direction. Maybe we'll know someone who can help you. Maybe we can actually help provide the answer about what kind of information you need, or at least find someone who knows that answer. And I think it's important to ask, find us and ask.
I'm curious about trials that put out post hoc analysis and the results of that. Sometimes you do see this from time to time. I'm wondering how valuable are those kinds of analysis, and is it justifiable for companies or pharmaceutical companies to put out these sort of data?
I can give my perspective first. Again, it depends on what purpose. You know, there are certain that's one of the big reasons you actually have a protocol and a protocol-defined analysis, is that's what you intend to do and that's what you stick to, and then you have a data or statistical analysis plan which has got to be done before the study conclusion, which sets out this is how I'm going to analyze the data and this is how I'm going to treat the data. You can do post-hoc analyses if you have, for example, gray zone outcomes. You think, okay, well, maybe I have to look into subgroups. Or so there are many cases, many times you can justify post-hoc analyses, but whether they'll be accepted because they are post-hoc, they might give you an insight into, you know, it's unusual to do post-hoc analyses if you have a clear outcome, a clear failure or a clear success. But there are many times where you don't have that and you need to do some post-hoc analyses to help guide you, well, where do I go to next? It's completely acceptable, but maybe not so much from a regulator if it is more post-hoc.
Certainly as a clinician, we would look at post-hoc analysis in general as being hypothesis generating rather than actual evidence.
So that, yeah, absolutely. And if you think about things like Herceptin and the EGFR inhibitors,
they actually came out through post-hoc analysis, and they're now very valuable drugs.
Yeah, so they're important. It's really important to do, but it's hypothesis generating and it guides where you go to next, more than providing you with general. That's a gross generalisation. Sorry, a couple more. We're going to have to wrap up in 5 minutes, so a couple more.
I've got a question about the countries that pharma companies choose and select to focus on for the clinical trials. Are there certain countries where commercial opportunities may be greater, so there's a lot more focus on having a larger clinical trial network there than, say, other countries?
I think we would probably say that's far more driven by the population and the incidence of the disease that you're trying to treat. So if you were doing hepatocarcinoma, you'd go to China. If you were doing, say, nasopharyngeal, you might go to China or Malaysia. If you were doing cardiovascular, you might go somewhere else. I don't think that we would do it for a commercial reason. We would do it rather for recruitment, speed of the trial, because, I mean, it's already been mentioned a number of times, a couple of months delay is money, and approval and first to market means a huge advantage to companies.
I completely agree, but also in the context of what I think what Megan was saying before about data acceptability. You know, you've got to obviously choose your sites and countries where the data is going to be acceptable on a global basis. There are some very specific, and this has been raised before, specific requirements by some Southeast Asian countries that they want to see data in their population. Japan is a very, very strong example of that. They want Japanese patient data. They have to justify it to the Japanese population. You know, we didn't approve this because it was studied elsewhere in the world. Japanese do consider themselves as unique. So they want to see some evaluation in their own population. But more, they're also saying, well, okay, we realize it's expensive and difficult to study just Japanese subjects, particularly in rarer diseases, so we will have a more of a pan-Asian approach, where we will accept data from Korea and maybe Taiwan, etc.
Is the US still the driving commercial market? So do you have to do things that will fit with the US? Are they still your major commercial market for most drugs?
I think US and key Western European countries, yes.
All right, wonderful. Thank you all very much. Thank you for coming. Please thank our panel. That was wonderful.